I would like to remember the two main points of yesterday. The first important result is about the continuity of the weak solution of our equation. And this continuity has been proved by assuming the right-hand side of the student class. So much more general than usual classical assumption. And after, sorry, I need to scroll. After this, we also proved the Herder continuity result. That is just a slight improvement of the previous result, because the class, the model space L1 lambda is contained in the Stuber class. So this means that there are functions that are not in L1 lambda and they are in Stuber. So if we take this more special function, then the solution has a consequence. It improves its regularity and now we have Herder continuous function instead of continuous function. Okay, so since this result is very important for the development of the PDE, now we come to the topic of this talk. That is about the necessary conditions for regularity. What I mean is this, I would like to revert the implication of the previous result in order to have necessary and sufficient conditions for the regularity. Of course, this is a very ambitious goal. In fact, this means that we could assign a given degree of regularity and then deduce what f can be put in the problem. So if I want to have the continuous function, but I choose the wrong right hand side, I cannot have a continuous function as a solution. If I want a continuous function as a solution and I assign bad f, I cannot get a continuous our solution that is continuous. So this point would be very interesting, this point. But in general, in its full generality, the problem is still unsolved. The problem has been solved just in a few special cases. And I will show you what is known today about this problem. I will assume that the right-hand side is a non-negative function. The things works, of course, also with measure, but it is important that they are non-negative. So I would like to review the whole list of regularity. So yesterday, you remember, I started with a very weak solution. Very weak solution. And now I have this. And I would like to see what happens to the extra integrability result. So now I need a special class that I didn't mention before. We just simply take the quantity you see here inside, the quantity that defines Stummel, and instead of taking the L infinity norm, that is this, and you get Stummel, you take the L norm. Okay? So this basis was introduced in the literature in 1984 by Schechter. It is just an announcement of the bulletin of the American Mathematical Society, just two or three pages. He introduced these spaces for other reason, not for PTE, but I tried to to use a PDA, a very weak solution. This is in general a very weak solution. Is in LP locally, if and only if the right hand side is in this Schechter space. The M is because Schechter is Martin Schechter, so M is for him. So let's see the proof. The proof is quite easy, but the result is different from the one that I introduced the other day, because in that occasion I had more spaces. So this means that for extra integrability, more spaces are not the right answer for the regularity in this sense. This is the right answer, because this is necessary and sufficient. But we see the proof. So let fix a compact, because the result is going to be local, and use the representation formula. So you see, I simply use the representation formula and the estimate for the green function. So the calculation are very easy. This U delta, I will define in a moment, is this one. Is the same integral of the complementary of the column. I should copy. And so this U delta is this function, this one. And we can notice it very easily because the argument of the integral is positive, the integral has a monotonicity with respect to the set. And so we have this comparison for any delta. So this means that this difference is between 0 and u. And u, by assumption, is LP. So we can take the limit in the integral. And if we take the limit, we get, you see, this result, but simply substituting the definition, you get this result. And now to go from here to Schechter space is very easy because you simply apply Green function estimates, so you replace G with the Kerbal potential, and you find this. So this means that the function f is in Schechter space. So one way is okay. So let's go in the other direction. Now assume that f is in this space and show that the solution has this given degree of regularity. This integral going to exponent here. Once again, representation formula. I put just this, less than delta, because you split the integral. But if you can choose as delta any delta, I take delta bigger than the diameter. So the other integral disappears because f is zero outside. So we can assume that our representation formula is in this form. And the integral belongs to LP. So you see, this integral belongs to LP, and this means, of course, that U belongs to LP. So the proof is very easy. So it's much easier than we expected.
Just a second. So do we use cos column here, or what? That's cos y minus 2 here. So do we use cos green function here?
Yes, I forgot to write the detail. Because the representation formula is with G. Sorry, there is a
mistake.
I was here.
Okay.
Start with G and then after that use the green function estimate.
Yes,
thank you. I will fix. So this is the necessary and sufficient condition of the very good solution. So integrability. invariability equivalent to MP.
Check the space.
So, so after the integrability, yesterday we had boundedness, continuity, and had the continuity. Let's see what happens now. So, this is the condition for boundedness. Yesterday we proved that if the right hand side is in S theta, then the solution is bounded. Of course, the result is also local, can be localized. And today I'm going to give you the reverse implication, but with the assumption that f is non-negative. So let's see the proof. Also, this proof is very easy, very short. So fix a compact, as usual, we take a point inside, a convenient distance from the boundary. Here all the results are local because the estimate for the grid function, the estimate from below, they are true when you are away from the boundary. Instead of the estimate from above, they are true in all the domain. So in the necessary condition, I always use estimates from below. So I could keep away from the boundary. So this is the reason why all the results are local, and I have to stay away from the boundary in any of this statement. So as you saw before, this is always the same trick. I use the estimate for the grid function you see from below. And then I have and this means that if u is something wrong here. If u is bounded by this inequality, also the function f is commutative, because you can say that this is bounded, but in general not infinitesimal. Okay. So this is the condition for boundedness. Okay? Because I want to use continuity. So this difference is quite easy to perform the calculation. Just to consider several cases where the point belongs to the boundary. It is possible to majorize this quantity with this function. That if we have fixed delta, we can majorize with this function that belongs to L1. This is our assumption. So this means that we can use Lebesgue dominated convergence theorem, and we, with fixed delta, we can pass to the limit for x tend to that goes to x0. So, moreover, if we look at the definition of u delta, I show you one moment, this one, okay, we realize that because of the positivity of the function f, u delta is less than u. So we have u delta less than u, converging to u, okay, converging to u, and moreover the convergence is monotonic because the integral is monotonic with respect to delta. So we apply moreover we know that the function u is continuous. This is our assumption because we are doing the reverse. So we have all the assumptions of the theorem. Then we can say that the convergence is uniform. So what does this mean? This means that this difference, the supremum, that is this, goes to zero. But if this goes to zero, as usual, we can consider this quantity and majorize with the previous one that goes to zero. So this means that the function f is in some, sorry. Yes, the function f is in some. So we have proved that if we have continuous weak solution, this is equivalent to f in Stuber, always with this extra assumption. So for example, we could apply this criterion as a criterion. For example, if we say I want a function that is in S tilde but not in S, then I take a function u that is locally bounded but not continuous, evaluate for example their Laplacian, and then I get different f that cannot be in the same class because the solution does not belong to the same class. So last step is about the continuity. What about the continuity? And the continuity is more delicate. The proof is a little bit longer than the previous. As usual, the continuity is we are connected with the George theorem, so it must be a little bit difficult. So we have to prove first Cacioppoli type inequality. Yesterday I reminded you what is Cacioppoli inequality, but only in a particular case. Let's say that Cacioppoli inequality, the original one, is the one that I reminded you yesterday. But in general, for any PD, if you have an estimate in which you have on the left hand side, you have the integral, I write here. If you have integral of the gradient square multiplied by something, in general, this is the left hand side, any inequality like this, we call a Cacioppoli type inequality. So, if you change a question, you can try to prove once again the inequality, and you find a slightly different inequality. So, since the proof of Cacioppoli original is very easy, very short, many times it's convenient to repeat the proof adapted to the equation. Then you find a different inequalities that are more suitable to your problem. So now here I repeated the proof of the classical Cacioppo inequality, finding something that is slightly different because I use our assumption. Now I want to characterize the tether continuity. I use the fact that I know that the solution is tether continuous. So tether continuity is equivalent to what? I would guess some more spaces. Because yesterday we showed that if f is in more spaces, then the solution is Hilbert continuous. But we have to see exactly what happens. And let's start with the Cacioppo-like inequality. Of course, I have to use everything I know. I know the solution is Hilbert continuous, but I also know that the solution is the weak one. Why I know this? Because since the solution is L continuous, it is also locally bounded. But and f is positive. So if it is locally bounded, the corresponding f, you see, is in S tilde. But we saw that S tilde is contained in W minus 1, 2. So the right hand side is contained in W minus 1. Minus 1, 2, and then the corresponding solution is weak 1. So we can work with a weak solution, not the very weak. And this is important because the Cacioppo inequality is for the weak solution. You see here, this is not finite if the solution is very weak. In general, the gradient is not integrable to this power, but less than this. Okay? So I cannot hope for the Cacioppo inequality if I know only that the solution is very weak. I have to know first that the solution is the weak one, then I can hope for the Cacioppo. Okay? So this is important to know that the solution is the weak one. So now we fix open set. And fixed this open set, U, as I told you, is a weak solution of this equation. And this means that we can start. Okay, this is another. Okay. In general, the solution is weak. I use the result about the necessary condition that I do before, but I would like to know if the restriction to another open set is still a weak solution. And this is a trick that we can prove this, because we can do the following. We can truncate the function f, level k, and produce a monotonic sequence converging to f that is positive. Then, since f is a truncation, there is in general a corresponding solution in k to this problem. So this is like an approximation of the function uk is a weak solution, so I write this definition for any phi, and now I simply take as a test function the approximate solution uk. You see here, as I told you in the days before, in the definition of variational solution, essentially the test function is as the solution. In fact, this idea is performed here, in which I take as a test function just the solution. This I can do because the test function is W1 to 0, and the solution is the weak one, so it is W1 to 0. So inserting this choice in the definition here, you get this inequality. This comes from the left-hand side. You get the square modulus of the gradient. This comes from the right-hand side. But you can majorize fk with f and uk with u. So you have a uniform estimate. And you can say that uk is weakly convergent in W1b for this values of p. So we can extract a subsequence, and this uk converges to u in W1b0. So we already knew that u was in W1b0, but now we have a way to approximate. So now this was preliminary to Cacioppo inequality. Now we try to show this Cacioppo inequality. You see, this is Cacioppo inequality because on the left hand side I have the square modulus of the gradient of the solution. Here I didn't put the test function, but of course you can always take a cutoff function. So such that it is identically one in some ball and zero outside, for example, double ball. So you can have a more clean inequality without any test function. You see, this is Cacioppo type, but the peculiarity of this inequality is that at the right hand side, you see, there are a lot of powers. This is because I have to use everything I know, and I know that the solution is ever continuous. So this power arises from this information. So let's see how is the proof of this inequality. So we start with a classical cutoff function, 1 in VR, between 0 and 1, control the gradient. And, I forgot to write that this is 0 outside of P2R. But, mimicking the proof of original Cacioppo inequality, we take as a test function this function. That is the square of the test of the cutoff function multiplied usually by U. But I can choose also U plus some constant. This time I choose to subtract the average of u over the ball of b2r. So this number is the average of the function. So I put this function as a test function inside the equation. And this is what this is the definition. And now simply I have to evaluate the derivative and insert in the definition. So evaluating the derivative, you see this is what you obtain, this one. Now you have a solution also on the right hand side, of course, and start using the assumption. First I use the ellipticity, so this integral decreases to this one. This is the ellipticity constant, this is the cutoff function. On the other side, we have there is a piece arising from here, the number 2. Another piece that is this one here. So now I have to try to take the term with the gradient, this ux, try to eliminate it, moving on the left hand side. At the same time, I can keep on the right hand side everything that contains u. So my first problem here is to move on the left hand side everything where there is a derivative of u. And this I do with an elementary trick. I use this very elementary inequality to split the product, and I can choose the convenient value of the constant epsilon. So according to the calculation, it's very easy to find what is the most convenient value. defining again against this integral now. So I can separate, and I obtain this. So this integral is measured this way, and applying the inequality, you see there is a piece with the square of the gradient of u, and another piece with the square of the remaining things. So in general, now choosing an appropriate value of epsilon, I can put this on the left hand side. The value that I choose is this, and you see this piece will remain on the right hand side. This is going to move on the right. So inserting again in the previous calculation, we get after simplification, I think, this is still the calculation. You see the same integral, different constant. But the important is that when I move on the other side, the coefficient is positive. So I can go on and obtain this. This is on the left hand side. On the other side, we have two pieces, one containing the solution, one containing the function f. Okay? And now I can use the continuity of the solution. And I can use it because this is the average of the function, but the function is continuous. So this is a value at some point. So this difference can be controlled with the distance to the power alpha. And using the definition of the continuous function, I get the Kirchhoff inequality. I want to show you the Kirchhoff. No? I'm getting confused with this technology. So, where it was Kirchhoff. Okay, this one. I want to show that here I have power to some distance to some power, distance to some power. And this expression comes from, now I go in the other direction. Okay, from here, you see, this quantity and this quantity becomes R to some power, R to some power, to the outside the integral. So this is the form of the Kirchhoff inequality that we have. We need also another preliminary lemma. A preliminary lemma that it was introduced at the time by Stampacchia. There are several lemmas of this kind, introduced by various authors very well known in the 60s. For example, in the Campanato book, there are several of these lemmas. In Stampacchia, Benedetto, many authors found useful to use a lemma like this one. You see, this is an elementary lemma, just calculus. But it is very useful when the function of omega of r is the integral of something related to the solution over a ball of radius r. So applying this lemma, we can get useful information. So the lemma essentially say that if you have this kind of inequality, where the important thing is that the constant eta must be less than 1. So you see, omega is increasing. So in principle, omega of 2r is bigger than omega of r. So this inequality has a hope only if eta is greater than 1. But if we know this with the eta very small, then we can deduce this conclusion. What does this mean? This means that I may throw away this piece, this omega of 2r, but I pay a price. The price is that I have to modify the exponent alpha. You see, here I have alpha, here I have lambda. Of course, lambda depends on alpha, but it is the price to pay to get rid of this piece. So if you want to have inequality, for example, in which on the left-hand side, I have some integral over a ball of regularity, but I have this, and I cannot eliminate this in usual way, then I can use this lemma to have my conclusion. So, this lemma I will not prove, the proof is very easy. And now, finally, we are ready for the Hilbert continuity, for the characterization of the continuity. So, this is the result, F positive, as usual, alpha is even, and we assume that the solution of this problem belongs to C0 alpha. As I said before, it is automatic that the solution is weak, not very weak. Then, under this assumption, the conclusion is that F must belong to this particular model space. So, there is something that I have to observe about the proof and also the result. As you remember, at the beginning I mentioned, at the beginning of the lectures, I mentioned the George result. And the George result, there exists an exponent of the continuity that depends on the operator. Depends on the space n and the operator through the ellipticity constant. So, in the statement I said, let us choose alpha. But we cannot choose whatever alpha we like, because the operator is given. The other continuity of the Georgi is something that depends on the operator. So we have to compare our alpha with the alpha from the Georgi. Okay. We compare this, and we of course have two cases, because if alpha bar is the exponent given by the theory of the Georgi, and alpha is our exponent, if we have, if our exponent is bigger than the Georgi one, I have nothing to prove. There is nothing to prove in this case, it's automatic. The only thing to prove is that I choose to give an alpha that is strictly less than the alpha bar. So, we recall the previous things. We know that the solution is the weak one, and for the reason that I told you before. And now we can start with the proof. So, we fix a positive number and prepare to use inequality like the one I used before. You see this. Okay? Then, take the integral of f over a ball, because I have to prove that function f belongs to n1 n minus 2 plus alpha. So I start considering this integral. Now I have to use in some way the definition of the solution. So I enlarge the ball using the positivity of f. In this ball, P2R, I put a test function that is identical to 1 in this ball. So I can have this monotonicity. Now that I have this, I can use the definition of weak solution, that is the identity between these two integrals. So this is the definition that I look on the reverse side. Now, here, I use the previous elementary inequality to split. I show you. This is the elementary inequality, okay? And I use it now to split this integral. Of course, I use also ellipticity, usual things, and then I get this inequality. Now, you see that I got here the gradient of U squared. So this is the reason why I need the Kirchhoff inequality, because Kirchhoff inequality can majorize this integral, that it was the left-hand side in Kirchhoff inequality. So, apply Kirchhoff inequality, and we get this on the left hand side, the integral f. On the right hand side, this is what we get after applying a Cacciocoli inequality. As you can see, you disappear. You disappear because it is under continuous. The gradient disappears because I use Cacciocoli. Okay? Only f is present. So, what are we obtaining now? Ah, note that when you apply a Cacciocoli inequality, the radius of the ball becomes the double. So here I have 4r. Okay? So you see, if this was integral of f over br, I simply move on the other side, I choose convenient epsilon and cancel. But this is impossible now, because the integral is over a radius, a ball of a larger radius. So this is why I need the Stampacchia lemma. The function in Stampacchia lemma is the integral of f over pr, omega of r. So here you can see omega of r constant, omega of 4r, plus some power as in the lemma. You see, it is very important to have a constant in front of this integral that is very small. But we are lucky because we have epsilon. So we can choose epsilon in such a way that the total constant, c times epsilon, is less than 1. And then we can apply the lemma. What say the lemma? The lemma say, OK, you can get rid of this piece, but you pay a price. The price is to modify the exponent. Doing the calculation, here there is some little typos, sorry, we get that the integral of f is majorized with this power. So, at the end we get here, f is in L1, let's say lambda for some lambda greater than n minus 2. Okay? There is some bias there. But the important thing is that the Elder continuity can come across the equation from the solution to the right hand side. The Mori exponent, when it is very high, becomes Elder continuity. The other continuity becomes more exponent when you go on the other side. So this is another way of viewing at the more exponent. It's something that converts the continuity in some integral property. So this is the last result about necessary conditions. Oh, we have a summary, I think there is some needs.
Yeah, yes. Yes,
okay. So, I have the summary, but before the summary, I would like to tell you what is the situation about this problem. The problem has been exploited also in some other cases. For example, in some degenerate case. Degenerate means that the ellipticity is not a constant anymore, but is a function of the point x. And this function can go to zero. Degenerate means this. If this function goes to zero, it's like you have the matrix A with the minimum eigenvalue that goes to zero. So it's like to lose some variables. The equation disappears in some sense. So degenerate means this. So, of course, as you understand, it is not possible to study degenerate equation in its general form. But we have to make some assumption on the function that exploit the degeneration. And in some cases, there is some result analogous to that one. But however, with f positive, any time with f positive. Also, there is the theory that I presented in these days has been also extended to some quasi-linear equation, some non-linear equation. But of course, as you can imagine, the theory is totally different because the main problem with nonlinear equation is that we have no green function. So we don't have any representation formula, and so nothing of this can be reproduced. You have to change totally your point of view. I decided to show you this theory because it is quite direct, quite simple. Because you see representation formula, you look at the solution as a potential. Since you are expert in Morris spaces, orlits, and the relation between potential, then you can see very well what means the solution through the representation formula. In the nonlinear case, the situation is much more difficult. You don't have a formula, so you cannot see the solution as a potential, because it isn't. Then you have to use other tools that have been developed. But now let's summarize what we have seen in these days. So you remember the first day, very important to understand the difference between different concepts of solution. Once you have this clear, then the PDE look clear too. And then the Green function is one of the fundamental tools for linear operator. I brought uniformly Elliptic operator, but the Green function can be constructed also in degenerate situation. And using our main tool, that is Green function representation formula, we have found some sufficient condition for regularity, and today I show to you what is reverting this condition in necessary condition. So this is, I think I can stop here, and I thank you very much for your nice invitation. The atmosphere of the meeting is very, very friendly, very warm. And also, boom boom, say thank you to you.